Hey everybody, welcome back to SFF 180. It is Mailbag Monday for April the 30th, 2018. I hope you guys have had a great week and a great weekend. Mine's been pretty good. Very productive last week, so this week expect two book reviews at least and a daily shorts. So I'm looking forward to getting those up, finally, at long last. One of the books is going to be a BookTube SFF Awards title. Also had a birthday last week. Yeah, that kind of interrupted the flow a little bit, but I got to have a yummy filet mignon dinner, and that was absolutely worth it. So, pretty decent stack this week. Good solid week, about 7 or 8 packages. So, let's not waste any more time. Check them out, see what we have. And this first one appears to be a random Penguin title. And we are getting off to a pretty solid start this week. This is an arc for Mecha Samurai Empire. This is a new book by Peter Tyrius. I believe it is a standalone story set in the same future as his previous book, United States of Japan. And this comes out September the 18th from Ace Books. So anyway, let's have a look. Mecha Samurai Empire, it says, has already captured the attention of Oscar-winning film director Guillermo del Toro and renowned game creator Hideo Kojima, who revels in the world Tyrius has created. That's nice. Maybe they'll develop it into another game that will then get canceled. I don't know. Oh, well. But let's see what it says about the story. Here it is. In his new novel, Tyrius tells the story of Makoto Fujimoto, Mac, who grows up in California, but with a difference. His California is part of the United States of Japan. After Germany and Japan won World War II, the United States fell under their control. Growing up in this world, Mac plays portico games, haphazardly studies for the Imperial exam, and dreams of becoming a mecha pilot. Only problem, Mac's grades are terrible. His only hope is to pass the military exam and get into the prestigious mecha pilot training program at Berkeley Military Academy. When his friend Hideki's plan to game the test goes horribly wrong, Mac washes out of the military exam too. Perhaps he can achieve his dream by becoming a civilian pilot. But with the tensions rising between Imperial Japan and Nazi Germany, and rumors of collaborators and traitors abounding, Mac will have to stay alive, long enough first. Okay. Well, looks like lots of fun. Comes out September the 18th, like I said, for those of you who are fans of the United States of Japan. So let me know in the comments. And then next in the stack, I have a good handful of these little white envelopes. They usually denote tour titles, but not necessarily. We'll see what we have. All right, this first one is not a tour title. It is the finished copy of Miss Subways, a new novel by David Duchovny. Yes, that David Duchovny. And as I recall, I think maybe about a couple of months ago, I did get an arc for this. And then it went in the pile, and I guess I kind of forgot about it. But here it is in finished form. And it comes out tomorrow, May the 1st. So let's have a look, see what this is all about. A woman stumbles into the realm of myth when a supernatural creature offers her a heartbreaking choice. It's in a tale based on an ancient Irish legend about two star-crossed lovers. Duchovny transposes the story to present-day New York. Emmer Gunnels, E-M-E-R, I guess so, is a masterful second-grade teacher who still experiences fleeting visions from a childhood brain tumor. Her boyfriend is Cuchulainn Constance Conn Powers, I guess Conn being the nickname, an academic who is writing an obscure right-wing treatise on pre-Christian deities and folklore. J.K. Rowling meets Michael Lewis in a London pub. They fucking have a baby that William Buckley raises, more or less. Okay. Things go dark when Emmer is confronted by Bean She, S-I-D-H-E, Bean, B-E-A, okay, a wildly profane Celtic fairy who offers her an impossible choice. Conn, who has been canoodling with the scary spider goddess Anansi, by the way, may live, but the lovers must separate forever, or he dies right here and right now. Golly. After a glimpse of how each choice plays out, Emmer makes her fateful decision. The man lives, love dies, declares she. Duchovny finds a deft balance here between Emmer's domestic rituals and the machinations of actual gods and monsters. Okay. And it's a Nora Ephron-esque romance in the sphere of Joseph Campbell, it basically says. An entertaining postmodern fairy tale that tests the boundaries of love and fate. Okay, sounds a little bit like it's all over the place, but, there's a high curiosity factor, of course, because of David Duchovny and all that. And Let's see, he has a four-city tour happening. Tomorrow he'll be in New York at Barnes & Noble Union Square, and then Cambridge, Massachusetts, LA, and San Francisco the week after that. All right. Well then, Miss Subways, out tomorrow. Let me know in the comments. And then maybe this one is from tour. Let us see. It is a tour book, and this one's kind of an unusual sort of thing for them. It's called The Military Science of Star Wars. Comes out tomorrow. It says, for those who enjoy deep dives into fandoms or have an unrelenting love of all things Star Wars, Tor is publishing The Military Science of Star Wars. Author George Beam, a former U.S. Army artillery officer, there you go, Thomas, provides readers an in-depth analysis of people, weapons, technology, and tactics employed by Star Wars heroes and villains. The Military Science of Star Wars spans all films from The Alliance to The Republic, Kenobi to Kylo Ren. Beam illustrates how a ragtag bunch of rebels could cobble together enough of a punch to topple an empire, and how that empire managed to subdue a galaxy with application of overwhelming force and technology. Okay, so if you're into thinking of Star Wars from a military SF standpoint, then I guess this is the book for the real military nerd in you, if you are so inclined. I'm actually kind of curious how nerdy this gets. AT-AT drawbacks. Drawbacks of the AT-AT. Despite its strengths, the AT-AT also has some drawbacks. Lack of speed. Moving at a maximum speed of 37 miles an hour. How do you work that out? The AT-AT is not ideally suited as a troop transport. It is simply too slow to move troops to the battlefield. Fields of fire. The AT-AT's firepower is strictly limited to the front. It lacks a topside gun and one in the rear for 360-degree protection. Yeah, well, that's a fair cop there. No anti-aircraft weapons, high center of gravity, no steel collar. Maybe those aren't as cool as we've been led to think. And it says this is not licensed and not approved by Lucasfilm. Okay, so this is just this guy's pure geekery. Enjoy it on those terms. This is, like I said, out tomorrow from Tor Books. And next up I have this little package here, which I'm guessing is a Saga Press title. It is, and this is an arc for Red Waters Rising. It's by Laura Ann Gilman, and it is the third and final book in her Devil's West trilogy. And this is a trilogy I've been wanting to start long before now. They've changed the covers on them. They've done that thing that everyone hates where they completely change the cover design of a trilogy halfway through, but oh well. But this comes out June the 26th, and I guess now I just read it as a whole trilogy, but I like fantasy westerns. And so, ideally, I probably ought to have started reading this a long time before. But anyway, let's see. Yeah, Red Waters Rising. In the concluding novel of the Devil's West trilogy, Isabel and Gabriel are riding the road to the southern edge toward the largest city within the territory, the Free City of Red Stick. Okay, then. 626 from Saga Press. And then we have this big one, which feels like a hardcover from Random Penguin. Oh good, I'm happy to see this. This is Ascendant by Jack Campbell, and it is the second book in his new series set in his Lost Fleet universe. And this is called the Genesis Fleet, and I think it's a prequel series. And I have I've had this on the pipeline to get started with this, because I have the first volume here, Vanguard, a paperback of it, and this is now Ascendant. And I have been on a bit of a space opera kick lately, because I'm like, ugh, fantasy, fine, I love fantasy, but I am missing science fiction, and especially space stories, right? So I'm like neck deep in space books right now, and I've been wanting to make these part of that. So now I have Vanguard and Ascendant to do that with. And I guess it deals with the ancestor of Black Jack Geary, who is the hero of the Lost Fleet series and all of that. So, okay. Military SF, but this guy writes very smart military SF. It's not like the jingoistic war porn stuff that you usually associate with military SF. It's very, very thoughtful stuff. And so, looking forward to this. On May the 15th from Ace Books in hardcover. Moving on down, we have one more from Random Penguin. And I'm very happy to see this. This is another trilogy I can now finish. This comes out July the 3rd from Delray Books, and it is Age of War by Michael Sullivan. And this is a prequel trilogy. This is set something like, if you've read the Rhyrea Chronicles books, and a lot of folks have, this is set like 3,000 years before that series. And so Age of War follows, Age of Myth? Well, I'm trying to refresh my memory. Yeah, Age of Myth and Age of Swords were the first two, and now Age of War rounds it out. I mean, I expect it to be a trilogy. That is often how he does things, but it could be more. On July the 3rd. Okay, second to last, this package comes from Nightshade Books. So it's nice to be starting to get some things from them again. Oh, I'm happy to see this. This is Volume 3 of the Best Science Fiction of the Year anthology series. This is the one edited by Neil Clark. I don't know how many competing Best SF of the Year anthology series there are now, two or three at the very least, but this is Neil Clark's, and I already got the arc for Gardner Dozois' anthology for this year. But this is Volume 3, and it says it comes out on April the 3rd, which is unusual. That would be a Thursday release date. Which is kind of strange. Most books drop on Tuesdays now. But okay, well, let's see what he has chosen. Try to kind of compare it very briefly to what's in Gardner's book, because Gardner's anthology does not have a lot of the stories that you might have expected to be in it. A lot of the stories that have ended up on the awards ballots, for example, for this year. Okay, Wind Will Rove by Sarah Pinsker is in here. I talked about that on Daily Shorts. The Martian Obelisk is in here. Those are both awards finalists. A Series of Stakes by Veena Jeemin Prasad, that is an award finalist. But then there are quite a few others. Hold Fast by Alistair Reynolds. A story by Peter Watts. Yeah, a whole lot of other stories that aren't actually in the finalists this year. My next Daily Shorts that is coming up is an episode where I am looking over some more of the finalists for the Hugos and Nebulas this year that I hadn't yet read. And I'll be honest, I'm impressed with some, not so much with others. So you can't necessarily look at awards ballots to determine what is best of the year. But this comes out, according to Nightshade Books, on the 3rd from Neil Clark, Volume 3. And finally, I have a package here that I'm a little bit anxious with anticipation about because it says it is from Macmillan, it's from Tor, and it says requested material on it. Now, I do recall pinging Tor a little while back and chatting with them and requesting a specific book. So let me see if this is in fact The Monster Baru Cormorant. Seth J. Dickinson, Book 2 of The Masquerade. It says it is an October title. Wow, it's here. Yeah, Book 1 broke me in half. So we'll see what this one does to me. But yeah, very much my number one most anticipated 2018 release right here in my hands at last. So yeah. Nothing else, I think, happens until I've read this. I don't think I'll be able to post my review until a little closer to the release date, but oh, hell yeah, I'm reading this. Okay, October from Tor. How monstrous will she get? We'll find out. And that's it, everybody. That is the mailbag for today. You know the drill. Light up those comments. Let me know which of these looks most interesting and exciting to you, and which you would like to see me prioritize for review. Otherwise, you know the drill. Hit the like button if you enjoyed watching, share the video, and above all, please subscribe. If you haven't done so, that is how the channel grows. Speaking of which, the 5K Q&A video, I figured something out. We're just going to do this the old-fashioned way, right? No, it's kind of boring, but we're going to do it this way. My email address, ba-ding, should be right there. Shoot me your questions in an email with a subject line, something like 5K Q&A. And I'll go through them and I'll pick, you know, the better ones and the more interesting ones. Anything you might want to ask me about books, about reviewing, questions related to science fiction and my life in science fiction, as 'twere. Okay? So that's how we're going to do that. And then I'll, in about maybe a week's time, I'll go ahead and record that video. You can also support the channel at my TeePublic store and at my Patreon, where recruits into Wink's Army get little perks like getting to see these videos at early access, a day early, stuff like that. I want to thank those people for their added support. I want to thank you guys for being amazing viewers. And until I see you all next time, happy reading.